Very good morning to all of you and welcome to this session. And I was just joking with my fellow panelists that probably we can have a conversation with each other, audience being so thin. But I think things are slightly more respectable at this time, and we do have some people sitting in front of us, which is very nice. Well, I'm very fortunate to have the kind of panelists that I have here with me. Professor Natarajan is a mentor and advisor for us at NBA. He having such a rich experience in higher education. And of course, everybody else has already been introduced to you. Professor Manoj Datta there is also very heavily involved with us, so also a good advisor for us. But there are many others, I think Professor Sahai too. So there are many of us who work together, at least for accreditation. And many of us argue a lot with each other on these platforms. So today we have received another platform to perhaps discuss things and answer your questions. To start, to get the ball rolling, this session is about accreditation and ranking. And I do not want to bind the speakers to what they want to speak about. And what I will do is I'll give each speaker about 10 minutes so that within an hour we cover whatever we have to cover from our side, and then leave about half an hour for an interactive session with all of you. I hope that's a workable solution. Okay. So having agreed on that, I have the chairman's privilege to start. So I will start. And I have a small presentation to give, but it will not take more than 10 minutes. That I promise. So what I want to speak about is only accreditation at the moment, because ranking is an area which I think, although I'm deeply involved in it, I think it is still a baby step for us, but I will certainly answer questions if they are asked in the end. So I'll focus primarily on accreditation. And I thought what I could do for this audience is really introduce to you what we perceive at NBA accreditation's purpose to be. And that's why I have titled my presentation as Closing the Loop. And I think you will soon see why. Because I want to think of accreditation as a tool for continuous improvement of program outcomes. That's what really accreditation is all about today. And just to give you a formal definition, accreditation refers to a process by which an institution which is being looked at is given a seal of approval by stakeholders in its activities, particularly in terms of whether they meet their expectations or not. So there are stakeholders, they have expectations, and basically you're giving a seal of approval, yes, what you're doing is fine. And stakeholders here refers to students, government, industry, faculty, and so on. But in my perception, accreditation goes well beyond that certificate that the institution earns. Therefore, I would not consider this certification to be the main aim of accreditation. For us, it's a process which encourages continuous look at how you teach, what is its impact, and how to achieve the set objectives better. It should lead to a continuous improvement system. And if I were to stick to this philosophy, let me tell you what NBA does, a top level view of that. NBA accredits today about 1,500 what we call tier one programs in engineering, and there are other programs, non-engineering programs as well, and a large number of tier two programs. I will not explain at this time what tier one and tier two means, but it will come out in the discussion later if it is required. And we use at the moment services of some 400 volunteers for this purpose. Projected need for the volunteers is much larger. More importantly, people who understand issues of quality and accreditation much better. So one of the purposes of this panel discussion is to identify the challenges and think of the future ahead. So I would project this as one of the important challenges for us in accreditation. How do we find, how do we develop quality and consistency of accreditation, which ultimately depends on the quality of volunteers that we deploy for this purpose. There is no dearth of volunteers, but volunteers who really understand the issues, who are competent, and who can do the job well. And that's a big challenge for us, and if the time permits, I'll elaborate on that later, but for the time being, let's move on. So that's one challenge that I will refer to. The other challenge has to do with understanding the nature of accreditation that I emphasized in the beginning, and let's talk about the focus on program outcomes, because today we are talking about education which is outcome driven. That is, you would like your graduates at the end of 4 years or 5 years to go into the industry, to go into the world with some knowledge and some skills and some attitudes having been inculcated. And we need to see whether those outcomes that we are desiring them to have, they have actually happened or not. And that's why the focus is on program outcomes. And if you look at the NBA criteria, I'm not going to go into the details of that. There are two criteria which deals with this particular issue. There is a criterion 7, which is concerned with continuous improvement in student program outcomes. And program outcomes itself is a criterion, which is criterion 3. And of course, let me skip some of these details. But program outcomes are central to short-term and long-term improvements in curriculum and pedagogy. And therefore, let me spend a little bit of time on curriculum and pedagogy. Let's talk about curriculum. If you look at curriculum design exercises in many Indian institutions, what they typically will do, and this is not a bad way of doing things, they will typically examine the practices in some good institutions, for example in IITs, and adopt them suitably, which is a good starting point for such a thing to do. It's workable, but not necessarily the best approach for your students and your objectives that you want to have for your institution. I suggest that we can consider a backward design approach instead for curriculum, and for that we have to list down an order of goals which we would like to have in front of us. And I have put down a few goals here which I think most of us will agree. One is, we want our curriculum to lead to improved student and learning in all its four dimensions, namely knowledge, skills, attitudes, and behavior. We would like to provide our students with a very good learning environment. We would like to make efficient use of our faculty. And of course, we'll be accountable to our stakeholders. If you do all this, accreditation will automatically happen. That's the way I would like to see things. If you do these five things, the sixth will follow. There's nothing that will stop you from getting an accreditation certificate that you're looking for. Unfortunately, if I go to the institutions, and as many of our volunteers tell us, the institutions do not see things in that way. More or less, broadly, the goals are the same everywhere. They cannot differ very much. After all, we are giving education, and education more or less means the same thing to all the people in all the institutions, but the priority of the goals is very different. And at the top of the priority comes accreditation. Without really understanding that accreditation should be a result of all those things and not the starting point of the whole effort. And of course, all the other goals that I mentioned are very much there in their system of processes, but they don't necessarily come in that sequence. So that's a very important difference between how things should be perceived and how they're actually perceived. And that's, I think, in my opinion, the second challenge. The second challenge of how do you engage faculty meaningfully in this continuous improvement, which will automatically lead to accreditation. And this, unfortunately, requires a fairly strong dose of methodology which people should be aware of. We have to get away from the paradigm where we think of ourselves as teachers who go teach a course and take exams, give grades to the students, and that's the end of the matter. Here you have to start looking at whether what I have taught has led to the outcomes that I wanted to be achieved in the first instance or not. And this is what I call assessment of outcomes. So there is an important new component that I'm talking about here, that is assessment of outcomes. And successful assessment requires faculty participation and engagement. And the focus of the faculty has to be here. Instead of what do we have to get NBA accreditation, the focus has to be how can we effect improved student learning and therefore better achievement of attainment of outcomes that are required. And that requires a transformational assessment, and this assessment would require collecting a lot of relevant data and then making good use of the data. I think I'll skip most of the slides so that I don't want to take all my time. I'll just look at one more criterion which is important here in the discussion, and that is the criterion 7. And I'll pick up a statement which is actually taken from Abbott and not from NBA, because it's very, very informative statement. So this is what the program must do to be a successful program in terms of accreditation. The program must regularly, and the emphasis is mine. The statement is from Abbott, but the emphasis is mine. The program must regularly use appropriate documented processes for assessing and evaluating the extent to which the student outcomes are being attained. The results of these evaluations must be systematically utilized as input for the continuous improvement of the program. Other available information may also be used to assist in the continuous improvement of the program. So you can see the emphasis points, and that's, in my opinion, the essence of accreditation. If you're doing all these things, things will naturally go up and up. So that's what I call closing the loop. Unfortunately, although this is something that we will all relate to, it's also the weakest link in our experience in most institutions seeking accreditation today, because they fail to spend enough effort and time in closing this loop in the manner that I just discussed. And I've come from an IIT system. I would say this is true even to some extent for the IITs, because they don't do it in so formal. So they have a large collection, large pool of good faculty, so they happen to do things right, but they don't necessarily have a system to do things right. And there are many reasons for this weakness. I'll not go into all that. And the more important thing is, this is the second challenge I'm referring to. Institutions have to change their attitudes. Faculty have to change their attitudes if accreditation is to be really successful. We have to go from a paradigm of grading to a paradigm of assessment. We have to go from just scoring right or wrong answers to understanding the whole reasoning process of the student. Instead of comparing students with each other, we have to focus on comparisons of students with respect to the outcomes that they are supposed to have achieved, whether they are there or not. And instead of this being an add-on exercise once in a while, it has to be a continuous exercise. So this is something that I would refer to as a second important challenge for accreditation. And towards this, both these challenges, I just want to make a statement that NBA is very, very aware of both these challenges. And as a result, we have two parallel efforts going on. One, a massive effort on the development of content for training of evaluators who go for accreditation. That's to address the first challenge. To address the second challenge, we are conducting a very large number of exercises practically in every state, with very large participation of colleges and institutions from each state, to spread this awareness, to spread the methods of assessment that they need to develop within the institutions, and to spread the culture of continuous improvement. I'll stop here. Thank you very much for your kind attention.